Good morning, guys. Sir DV here again to discuss to you some concepts on structural connections. So in my previous lecture on structural fasteners, I discussed to you some basic concepts and computational procedures in the analysis of bolted and riveted connections. Today I will be giving you some concepts again on structural welds in the form of basic procedures on how the welding process is conducted, and later on we will try to deal with some computations on the strength of welds. So structural welds is simply a process of joining metal pieces together by heating to a plastic or fluid state with or without pressure. So the historical development of structural welds dates back from simple processes first known as forging or pressure welding. So this is simply a fabrication of copper pipes from sheets by overlapping and hammering, which dates back to 5500 BC. So the next is what you call the brazing. This is a process in which the base metal is not melted but allowed to fuse together by tinning. So the tinning procedure here simply refers to the soldering procedure we normally use today. Brazed welding is actually an upgrade or an improvement of the brazing procedure, when the base metal is melted and allowed to fuse together by forging and tinning. So there is a pressure applied, okay? There is a pressure applied. At the same time, the soldering process or the tinning process is simultaneously made for the base metal to join, no? To the other component. So vulcanizing is also a term used in the old days, wherein the meaning of vulcanizing is really very much applicable to a welding process. So vulcanizing simply refers to hardening. Okay, so the meaning is simply to harden, upon which after which your pieces of metals are placed together, you allow it to be fastened together by hardening. So these four methods here are actually historical methods and are already forgotten as far as the welding art today is concerned. So for the later development on the welding process, we have the proponents here enumerated advanced procedures were actually made to improve the historical art of welding. And Thompson in 1877 invented the resistance welding, in which your metal are actually given some some electrical energy, no? To form a resistive property that makes the welding process possible, no? So these are of course used on very thin, very thin and very soft metals, no? Because the resistance welding back then is limited to reducing a lot of electrical energy, no? For the metals to join together. And Zerner in 1885 uses an arc welding process wherein carbon are used as the electrodes. So this is now the start of the arc welding, wherein the word arc here simply pertains to a source of energy, okay? An electric arc that will melt, no? the metal at a certain temperature and fuse it together with or without the presence of a filling material. So Slavyanov and Coffin in 1888 uses uncoated metal electrodes instead of carbon electrodes, which was used by Zerner. And then Straw Mayer in 1889 made use of coated metal electrodes instead of uncoated metal electrodes that were used by Slavyanov and Coffin. Fletcher, Fauci, and Picard in 1901 uses another source of energy, which is the oxyacetylene gas, to allow heat, no, to fuse metals together. And in 1914 to 1918, the gas tungsten arc welding, or simply the gas metal arc welding, which is known today, was actually invented. And later in 1932, the submerged arc weld, which uses a granular flux with continuously fed electrode, where the arc is buried under this granular flux, and the importance of this granular flux will be discussed to you later in the next slides. So the most common procedure in welding today, which is commonly known as the manual stick electrode process, is actually the shielded metal arc weld, or what you call the SMAW procedure. No? So heating is accomplished by simply providing an electric arc between the coated electrode and the base metal, as shown here in the figure. Now, so this is the source of the electric arc. Okay, so this is now the arc upon which this metal will actually absorb heat and thereby allowing it to fuse to another component. Metal component. So if we take a look at how this arc welding circuit is is actually used in the shielded metal arc process. So the word shielded there simply means that a gaseous shield, okay, coming from the production of this electric arc stream will actually shield, no, the vicinity of the joint, the welded joint, protecting it from contamination. Okay, so this electrode here may be coated or uncoated. Usually for the small welding, the coating here will be the one to produce this gaseous shield, while the electric wire or electrode wire will somehow be serving as the filler for the welding, the welded joint to be much more fine and smooth, no, along the process. So the coated electrode is consumed, okay, and this is transferred from the electrode to the base material. So the electrode wire becomes a filling material, while the coating is converted to a shielding gas, a slug when it cools down, and some are absorbed in the metal. Okay, the shielding gas is actually very important because it prevents the atmospheric contamination, meaning the formation of nitrides and oxides coming from air may cause some properties, no, such as embrittlement. The electrode coating may perform the following function. It produces the gaseous shield, okay, and stabilize the arc. So the gaseous shield excludes it, the welding the welded joint from the atmosphere. So it also introduces deoxidizing materials for a finer grain weld structure of the welded metal, and this produces a blanket of slag, okay, over the the molten pool, which has something to do with the exposure of the welded part from the atmosphere, retarding sudden cooling. Okay, so it retards cooling, and this cooling again may cause some unwanted properties like residual stresses may develop in the form of tensile and compressive stresses. So for the electrode designation, AWS 2.23, table 3.1, so the designation such as the E60XX or E70XX for the small weld, okay, so this the shielded metal arc weld simply indicates the strength, no, the tensile strength 60 and 70 respectively. So the X's there refers to some factors which actually has something to do with these four conditions, no? The suitable welding position, the recommended power supply, the type of coating, and the type of the arc characteristics. So for high carbon low alloy steels, low hydrogen electrodes are required by the AWS 2.23 to be used with the SMAU for all steel having yield stresses higher than 36 KSI. No? So this is so because low hydrogen electrodes have some properties pertaining to a carbonate. Okay, so this is a carbonate of soda, which is also called lime coating. So the carbonate of soda simply have some properties, alkaline properties, that controls acidity to to be concentrated on the welded joint. So the submerged arc welding, on the other hand, is actually similar to the shielded metal arc. The only difference is, in a saw process, the arc is not visible since there is what you call a blanket of fusible material that's covering the process, not itself. So this flux, or simply the material, comes from the machine or the equipment in which the electric arc has no way of being contaminated from the atmosphere. Okay, so the electric arc is actually invisible, no? Such that this part of the welding process is assured, no, of not being contaminated. So the bare metal electrode is consumable in that it is deposited as a filler material, just simply the same as the SMAW process. So the end of the electrode is kept continuously shielded by the molten flux, over which a deposited layer of unfused flux in its granular condition is actually laid ahead from the advancing electrode. Okay, so there is the unfused flux in a granular condition that serves as your shield. Okay, so the shield here is no longer simply a gas, but really a blanket, no? A blanket shield. So this prevents sputtering, sparks, and smokes being produced, thereby having a much more superb welding welded joint. Okay, the quality, ductility, and the strength, the density is high, and a very good corrosion resistance is expected when you use a submerged arc welding process. So the mechanical properties comparable to the base material, meaning say the strength of the weld itself, is almost the same, if not exceeding the properties of the base material. So the combination of the bare electrodes and granular flux are classified under AWS A5.17 or A5.23, which are designated as FXXX, thus EXXX, where the first X following the F is the first digit of the tensile strength, 7 for a 70 KSI. So this can be F, a 7. The second X indicates the condition of hits, let's say A for welded, and T for post welded, or as welded and post welded. And the third X indicates the lowest temperature at which impact strength of the weld metals meets or exceeds 20 foot pounds, or simply 27 joules. Okay, so you have here a 27 so this F7A27 means 70 KSI as welded with 27 joules strength. Okay, so 6 means the char PV notch impact strength is at least 27 J at 60 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, so sorry, but you don't have to use directly the strength there, but simply the code upon which this 27 joules was obtained. So You put here 6, okay, to indicate, and then as usual, so you have a CE70, XX will depend, the last two will depend on the conditions set forth on electrode properties. Okay, for the gas metal arc welding, the electrode is a continuous wire that is fed from a coil through the electrode holder, so a gun-shaped device as shown. So this is a typical schematic illustration of what the GMAW or the GMAW process equipment is as shown. Okay, so you have here a continuous coil of wire. Here in the electrode, you have also a shielding gas, just the same as your submerged arc welding process, and you are using a gas supply for your energy, heat energy source. Okay, so these are simply the different parts of how the GAS or the gas metal arc welding, the GMAW process, is concerned. So the shielding is entirely from and externally supplied from a gas or a gas mixture. So high rates of filler material can be transferred, and the gaseous shield that is uniformly provided around the molten weld. Okay, because the filler material is continuously provided directly, you know, on at the tip of the electric arc. So the shielded gas serves the following function: in addition to protection of the molten metal from the atmosphere, so it controls the arc and the metal transfer characteristic, so affects the penetration with the fusion shape, the weld region, affects the speed of welding, and it controls undercutting. So undercutting is simply a faulty result of the welding process, in which there is a slight depression, no, surrounding your welded your welded joint. Okay, so there's some undercutting or depression on the welded joint. So if this is the weld, the two metals that were welded, so there is a some sort of an undercut that may happen somewhere here. Okay, so there's a depression, meaning to say, okay, so undercutting on this. So other welding process which are not discussed here in this lecture are the flux cord arc welding, the electro gas welding, okay, so a combination of electric and gas, the electro slug welding, and the stud welding. So that's it for the basic concepts on welds. I'll see you on the next video to continue with some more concepts pertaining to the weldability of structural steel. Thank you very much for listening. Have a nice day.